It's Professor Dave. Let's graph some ellipses.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We just learned how to graph circles, so let's move on to the next type of conic section, the ellipse. Let's recall that while a circle is the conic section formed when a plane intersects this cone parallel to the base, an ellipse is what we get when this plane is not parallel to the base, but it still just intersects one half of the cone. So that's one way to define an ellipse. Another way is to say that an ellipse is the set of all points surrounding two foci, whereby the distance from a point to one focus plus the distance from that point to the other focus is constant. No matter what point we are looking at on this ellipse, the sum of these two distances will be the same. As it gets closer to one, it's farther away from the other, and vice versa. The midpoint of the line segment that connects the foci is the center of the ellipse. Ellipses also have two axes of symmetry, a major axis, which will be the longer one, and a minor axis, which is the shorter one. At each end of the major axis, we can find a vertex, and that's all the terminology we need to know. The standard form of the equation of an ellipse that has its center at the origin looks like this. It's similar to the equation for a circle, but we have these terms, A and B, which give us information about the major and minor axes. Specifically, the major axis has a length of 2A, and the minor axis has a length of 2B. Or we could think of A as the distance from the center to a vertex on the major axis, which means that positive and negative A are the x-intercepts, and positive and negative B are the y-intercepts. Beyond this, we can use this equation, c squared equals a squared minus b squared, and if we solve for c, that is the distance from the center to either of the foci. If an ellipse has its equation in standard form, with a 1 over here, it's very easy to graph it. Say we have a 9 for a squared and a 4 for b squared. That means a is 3 and b is 2. So we would just draw the four intercepts, connect them, and there's the ellipse. The foci are not part of the ellipse, but if we need those as well, that will come from c squared equals 9 minus 4, or c equals plus or minus root 5. We should note that a is always greater than b, so if the term below x squared is greater than the term below y squared, we have a here and b here, which produces an ellipse that is wider than it is tall. But if the other number is larger, then this term is a squared and this other term is b squared. This is because the ellipse will now be taller than it is wide. But the A term must always correspond to the major axis, which is the longer axis. So that will now be the vertical axis given by Y. Let's say we have an equation for an ellipse where this number doesn't equal 1. We will have to divide the entire equation by this term so that we get a 1 on this side, as it will be easier to graph in standard form, even if we end up with weird numbers for A and B. We could also graph an ellipse if given information about its foci and vertices. Say the foci are at plus and minus 1, while the vertices are at plus and minus 2. That means that C is 1 and A is 2. It will then be true that 1 equals 4 minus B squared, or B squared equals 3. Then we just put A squared and B squared into the standard form, and there's our equation. Ellipses can be transformed by some of the ways we already know, except in this case. We can write x minus h quantity squared and y minus k quantity squared rather than x squared and y squared, and these h and k values will be the horizontal and vertical shifts, respectively. Notice the minus signs, so x minus 2 will mean a shift of 2 to the right, not left. When we have h and k terms, the ellipse has a center at the point HK, and everything else we learned about the axes and foci will stay the same. That's really all we need to know about ellipses right now. These are extremely important shapes for astronomy and astrophysics, so if you move on to my astronomy course, you will learn all about how celestial objects, like planets and comets, follow elliptical orbits rather than circular ones, as originally thought many centuries ago. But for right now, we've got a lot more math to cover, so let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.